And tonight on PM Express, a conversation that got heated since the Health Committee of Parliament found out that 16 million Ghana cedis was paid to a middleman, Sheikh Al Maktoum, in the Sputnik vaccines procurement contract that has since been terminated. In the last few hours, though, we've cited a letter signed by the Health Minister, Okwajiman Menu, demanding a refund of the money from Sheikh Al Maktoum. But tonight, there are questions about the vaccines that were procured and for which this amount was paid. When did the country receive those vaccines? Where were they stored? In fact, where are those vaccines? There's a question about the committee that did the probe not recommending prosecution after finding out that a number of procedures were breached. These are answers we'll be seeking tonight, and also share details of that letter asking for the refund. But the bigger question tonight remains calls for the health minister to resign justified. And of course, Occupy Ghana is the latest to join calls for the health minister to resign or relieved of his post. The minister has explained that he did it out of frustration, but the minority was the first to call for his removal after the Sputnik V committee presented its report. It's followed by constitutional lawyer Martin Kpebu, who supports calls for members of the general public to petition parliament for the health minister to be tried by the House for perjury. You remember he told the committee that he did not pay any money to the middleman Al Maktoum. The committee now found that over 16 million cedis has been paid to this man. Now, minority MPs were upset last week when the second deputy speaker called off a vote on the fate of the minister. And the minority leader has since assured his side will not back down on its push to get the health minister out of job. Now, the committee concludes that government paid Dubai-based businessman Sheikh Al Maktoum over 16 million cedis for the vaccines. And that's what the findings of the committee has been since it supports presented its report to Parliament. This is despite claims by the health minister under oath that, and I quote, "To the best of my knowledge, we haven't done any payment." That was exactly what the minister told the committee. Now, the Ministry of Health did not comply with the requirements of Article 1815 of the Constitution in respect of its agreement with Messrs. Al Maktoum. And that's a finding of the committee that probed the matter. The committee found that the Ministry of Health did not seek approval from the Board of PPA under Sections 40 and 41 of Act 663 before signing the agreement. Again, the committee found that the ministry entered into the two agreements without cabinet approval, but only based on a ministerial decision. And again, he explained he was frustrated with the situation, so he had to take that decision. Now, on whether the Ministry of Health sought advice from the Attorney General, officials of the ministry answered in the negative. The committee urges the Minister for Finance to take steps to recover the money due the Republic in respect of the amount of 16.33 million cedis that has been paid to the man. And tonight we've cited a letter. We'll be sharing that letter with you, asking Sheikh Al Maktoum to refund the monies that were paid to him. There are a number of issues that have come up before this letter was issued. I'll take a break. We'll get into that conversation when I return from the break. Welcome back to PM Express. My guest tonight, Bernard Ahiafor, he's MP for Akachi South and member of the Sputnik Committee that probed this procurement. Adam Senanu is anti-corruption crusader. He will be joining us shortly. And Kofi Bento, who is a lawyer himself and vice president of Imani Africa. Let me thank you, all of you, for joining the discussion tonight. But it's only also fair that we start with the letter that we've cited this evening from the Health Ministry, and it reads, I wish to, and it's titled Refunds the Government of Ghana of the balance of payment for 300,000 doses of Sputnik V vaccines. I wish to formally accept your termination of our agreement dated 9th March 2021 for the supply of Sputnik V vaccines as per your letter dated 14 July 2021. By this letter, I wish also to formally request for the refund of the remaining amount for the non-supplied doses, which should be the total amount paid to your office minus the amount due for the 20,000 doses you already supplied, in line with your earlier email dated 25th July 2021, in which it was affirmed that on the 13th April 2021, funds were transferred into your accounts as 50% advance for the initial batch of 300,000 doses. This request for refund is in line with clause 8.82 of the agreement, which states that any termination of this agreement, which shall be by notice in writing to other party, shall not affect any rights, remedies, obligations, or liabilities of the parties that have accrued up to the date of termination. It will be very much appreciated if the amount is transferred back into the sending bank account as per the earlier SWIFT advice dated 9th April 2021. You may contact Alhaji Inua Yusuf Esquire, Head of Legal Affairs, on telephone number, and it states the number. And this letter is signed by Kwaku Adjumann Mainoo, who is a Minister for Health, and copied to Minister for Finance, Deputy Ministers for Health, and Chief Directors of Ministry of Health. Let me start with you, Ms. Ahia, for your committee, the committee that you're a member of, recommended that monies paid to Al Maktoum be refunded. How do you receive this letter from the Ministry of Health?
Well, it's a step in the right direction, though they are late in writing that particular letter. I said so because the evidence available indicates clearly that as of 31st March 2021, a letter was written informing the Minister of Health that an amount of 16,331,640 Ghana cedis was paid to the private office of His Highness Sheikh Ahmed Dalmouk Al Maktoum, when in fact the vaccine supplied was 20,000. Meanwhile, the amount represents 50%, and the 50% out of 300,000 should have been 150,000 vaccines. So clearly, having realized that the only 20,000 out of 150,000 was supplied, meanwhile, this huge amount was paid, steps should have been taken long ago to retrieve this amount of money in view of the fact that the Sheikh indicated that he can no longer supply the item. Two, I was not personally happy because when a minister was confronted about the issue of payment, he told the committee that he cannot remember any payment made to Sheikh Al Maktoum. When in fact, he was the first person copied with a letter emanating from Bank of Ghana to the effect that payment has been made. So knowing very well that payment has been made, he should have even taken this step long ago, but not to wait for the committee to make that particular recommendation before now taking the step.
So your committee that worked on this probe, your own chief whip, Muntaka Mubarak, including many other Ghanaians, have questioned the work of your committee for not recommending specific sanctions for the Minister of Health, even though you've cited that the minister breached, he breached Article 1815 of the Constitution. He breached PPA procedures under Section 40 and 41 of Act 63. How is that?
Well, it is an ad hoc committee. And the ad hoc committee, we are giving terms of reference. And if you look at the terms of reference, we are supposed to make determination. So we have made a determination and laid a fact bare before the General House. So it is left with Parliament.
All right, so that is Mr. Hiafo there. He's a member of the committee that probed the... Okay, so I'm told he's back. Mr. Hiafo, make your point.
Yes, we are fact-finding committee. And we found the facts, we laid bare before Parliament, and it is left with the Parliament to take a decision as to the actual sanction to be meted out.
But you also make recommendations. You did not recommend that the minister be sanctioned. Okay, so Mr. Hiafos, he's having challenges with the internet there. Mr. Hiafo, kindly unmute for me.
I believe strongly ad hoc committee being fact-finding committee. It is not incumbent upon us to say that this is the kind of punishment that is supposed to be given to the minister. We have done our work and we brought the facts to Parliament. It is left with the entire House to take decision. Remember, whatever the committee may even come out with by way of a sanction, it's not binding on Parliament. Parliament will have to take decision. Therefore, we thought it wise making the fact known to the General House to enable the House to take decision.
So you recommended that the monies be retrieved, and you think it wasn't in the right step for the committee to also recommend that the minister be brought to book for breaching some constitutional procedures?
Well, I believe strongly that when a procedure is set down for a right to be exercised or an act to be carried out, it is that procedure that will have to be followed in doing it. So we investigated, came to a conclusion and finding that the minister ought to have come to Parliament for approval, because the agreement with...
We're having a terrible connection with internet with Bernard Ahiafos Zoom, but we'll try and get him back because he's very key to this discussion. I'm happy that Mr. Bentel has also joined us. Kofi Bentel is a lawyer. He's also the vice president of Imani Africa. Mr. Bentel, I'm grateful for your time. Now, indeed, I understand a bit about mounting pressure to actually ask the Minister of Health to resign because of the way he has conducted himself. And of course, the unending questions that require answers. But really, let's scrutinize the work of the Health Committee in Parliament. Satisfied with the committee's work?
Good evening. Do you hear me, please?
Loud and clear.
Good. So I think it's a reasonable explanation if the subcommittee says that they have done the fact-finding and they are releasing their report to the plenary so that further recommendations will be made. I thought that in the face of the gravity of the issues, the committee should have gone a bit further to make recommendations so that such a thing will not happen or be repeated again. And that is why I fault them. To the extent that the plenary or other organs of parliament may make the necessary recommendations so that we can avoid these things, I think we can, wait for those to happen. Look, we have to be happy or grateful for small mercies. And in this situation, at least the committee has done a job and put out the obvious. And the obvious is that every arm of government failed. And for me, that is the important thing. Even Parliament was lied to, and Parliament has not taken any serious action. I said before that maybe the action will follow. But for now, what I think Parliament should be minded, to deal with is that if a minister can come before Parliament and under oath tell them something which is an untruth, and they let that person walk, they have totally undermined their own importance in the scheme of things. If a minister can do all the things that have been done and the person does not pay any serious price and the laws of this country do not have anything to say about it, then I am not sure what kind of governance we are running. I said already that from the ministry level, from the civil service level, from the Bank of Ghana level, from cabinet level, from all those different levels of governance, where there should be sufficient structures to make sure a thing like this does not happen. I think we have suffered a catastrophic failure, and we need to get to the bottom of it. Here's the truth. Parliament is the only institution where we have representatives with the necessary power to get into these matters and find us the answer. We don't want for somebody to go to charge or somebody to go to some other place. That will only happen if we think that Parliament is failing in its oversight. So I am watching, and I think many more people are watching, what Parliament will do to try and salvage whatever is left of this system and to try and make sure that under their watch, things like this will not happen again. It may be a good lesson for all of us. If there are loopholes, we should block them.
Mr. Bento, what ideally, aside asking the minister to resign, should have happened to the minister for breaching constitutional procedures and also telling a lie before no mean committee than that of parliament? You're a lawyer.
You know, there are many laws that have been triggered or should be triggered in this regard. A lie under oath is perjury. Lie under oath in parliament is an offense against parliament. Okay, so on that alone, one action can trigger different kinds of, you know, responses. So there are two things to answer there. Lying in parliament under oath and generally lying under oath as perjury. And then there are the issues of, you know, procurement, there are the issues of, you know, the government's own policies, and then you get into situations where laws such as causing financial loss to the state could kick in. And there are many other laws that will kick in. When things like this happen, it really falls to whoever is in charge to determine what kind of charges to level against that person. It is not difficult to appreciate that something very wrong has happened. One, somebody clearly took public funds without proper authorization, transferred it to somebody else outside this country who did not have any authority to receive those funds. That alone triggers a whole host of things, you know. So, again, one of the problems is the fact that we have not heard much from the person's boss, that is the president, the chief of staff, the people who have oversight over the Minister of Health. We haven't heard what went wrong and why we basically do not know what is going to be done about it. So if you ask me what could, you know, be triggered, I don't know what cannot be triggered in this instance. I mean, everything along the line seems to have been breached, all right? Procurement, approval, transfer, you know, due diligence, value for money, everything seems to have been, you know, broken down, which is why I asked the question. It is like a total breakdown of government. So we need to see what the system will do to recover from this catastrophic failure and to restore our confidence in that system or in government to the effect that something like this cannot happen again. Or if there have been mistakes, then lessons have been learned, then we can avoid it in the future.
Right. So Mr. Tenano is also joining Vazo. Mr. Tenano, there's been a lot of calls for the minister to resign or be asked to step aside by the president, if I may say. But of course, should this be our priority when we've been told of breaches of constitution, constitutional procedures, and worse of it, a lie to parliament?
Well, I think that, I mean, parallel to that are all the requests of additional investigation. For example, into the processes, the paper trail in the Ministry of Finance leading to the payment. Because to the extent that all the supporting documentation was not complete, he didn't have parliamentary approval, he didn't have PPA approval, they didn't have 50% of the consignment on site. How did we manage to make the 16.3 million Ghana cedis payment? So the demand that he should resign honorably is just one in a gamut of issues that are being raised by civil society and other stakeholders. And I don't think that it's the most important. We're just saying that, look, when the man said to the best of his knowledge the money had been paid, I sighed. It was a sigh of relief. I was like, okay, thank God we are not losing money in this case. Only for us to discover that as far back as March, all these things, processes have started. So, yes, we are asking him to do the honorable thing. Otherwise, the president should be so minded. But beyond that, we need further and better particulars as to how we arrive where we find ourselves today. Because so much seems to have gone wrong. One is wondering, is this the only instance? Are there other things we need to take a microscopic look at to find out what has happened over the last 1.5 years?
Now, Ms. Ahiafor, if you're there, your minority, your leader, the minority leader, as well as your chief whip, has vowed to keep pushing for the minister to lose his job. I mean, how do you intend to achieve this?
Well, Parliament can pass vote of no confidence. So I recall that after submitting the report of the committee, the minority chief whip was amending the initial motion that led to the formation of the committee so that there will be an element of censorship. That is one step. Now, having listened, clearly, perjury as an offense has been committed. Two, there may be issues or privileges, because for you to come and blatantly lie before a parliamentary committee, not on one occasion, you appeared before the Parliamentary Committee on Health, and you told them that the price or the cost of the vaccine will not exceed $10. When in fact you have already signed a contract of the price of the vaccine being $19 and then $26, because the minister appeared before the health committee on 22nd and 23rd. However, he signed a contract before that date on the 9th and 16th of March with the Sheikh and SL Global respectively. And then the cost of the vaccine for these contracts were $19 and then $26. The SL Global $26 was subsequently, by an amendment to the agreement, brought down to 18.5. Yet, you appear before the committee telling them that the price per dose will not exceed $10. That clearly is a matter of privileges. Now, you appear before the ad hoc committee, and on oath, you said you have no idea about
All right, so it looks like the internet has failed again. Bernard Ahiafor, okay, I'm told he's back. Bernard Ahiafor, make your point, Ms.
Yes, to appear before the ad hoc committee speaking on oath to say that you have no knowledge of payment being made to Sheikh Al Maktoum, when in fact, on 31st day of March 2021, you have been duly informed that payment in the sum of 16,331,640 Ghana cedis in dollar equivalent was paid to the person. Clearly, this is not good enough, and I least expected the minister to do this. That one is perjury, and it also constitutes a matter of privileges. So Parliament can look at the Standing Order 28 and Standing Order 30 and see whether the conduct of the minister constitutes a matter of contempt of Parliament, so that the necessary proceedings will be brought against the minister. Remember, some are proposing that the matter should be referred to the special prosecutor for further investigation. We have laid a fact bare to Parliament. We have laid a fact bare to Ghanaians, and a holistic decision must be taken as to how we proceed against the minister. If it were to be some regime, the minister would have honorably resigned, or by now his appointment would have been terminated.
The second deputy speaker of parliament last week, when you laid that report, I mean, you were expecting to vote on the minister, but that did not happen. What makes you think that all the things that you intend to do to push this to happen will happen?
Well, There were two things that should have happened. One, the report of the committee must be adopted by the House. Before the adoption of the report of the committee, the minority chief whip moved that he wants to amend the initial motion so that there will be an element of censorship. And I believe strongly if the speaker had put it into voting, would have carried the day. But in his own wisdom, he has decided to defer the question. So he didn't put the question. For me, I'm not happy. But he is a speaker, and that is the decision that he has taken.
Mm. The other question I want you to clarify for me, which your own chief whip, Muntaka Mubarak, demands answers, is when the Sputnik V vaccines purchased were received in Ghana. And he also asked the question about where it was stored. I mean, we are told that 20,000 has already been purchased. And where is it now? Where are those vaccines? Did the committee find out?
Well, the committee did not find out. Because remember, we are giving terms of reference. And none of the terms of reference given to us was to the effect that we should find out where the 20,000 dosage were kept. So we did not go to the extent of making that particular categorical finding. You know, until the committee sitting, we didn't even know that 20,000 has been supplied. But it was the minister that informed the committee that 20,000 had been supplied, just to prove that the Sheikh had an ability to supply the vaccine to Ghana. Because we questioned the minister that you could have engaged in getting the vaccine from a direct source, government to government a source, or you contact the manufacturer directly. He claimed he never contacted the manufacturer directly. There was no government to government source. People were making the allegation that government to government source failed. That was why he resorted to a private entity. That is never true. Because regarding Sputnik V, the minister brought to us Exhibit 10 and Exhibit 11. One was a letter written to the Russian Minister of Trade. The other one was a letter written to the Foreign Affairs Minister of Russia. And all these letters were written after the contract had been entered into and concluded. Negotiations started on the 3rd March. They concluded and signed the contract on the 9th March. But the first letter trying to get the vaccine from a direct source was dated 23rd of March. And then the other one was 28th of March. So clearly, the contract was signed before any ostensible attempt to get the vaccine from a direct source. So clearly, I must admit to the fact that we did not make any finding regarding where the vaccine, the Sputnik V vaccine, that is the 20,000 that he alleges had been supplied, was, whether it has been used or it is still in stock, we do not know.
Do you sense that your colleagues on the majority side are making attempts to cover up this issue?
Well, for me, in my life, I believe calling a spade, but not a long fork. The fact is a fact. You cannot.
All right, so we'll try and bring Ms. Ahiafor back. But Kofi Bento, let me ask you this. Do you foresee this whole matter being caught up in the political web?
Well, it is already caught up in politics. And we cannot run away from that. Look, nobody can do this if they do not have political cover. Nobody can take $2 million of state funds and transfer them if they do not have political cover. So this is what I think those in political office must appreciate. This has gone beyond the minister. This is no longer an issue regarding the minister. This is a matter that will remain a reference point on this government, and how it will be referred to will be determined by how this government reacts to what we are all finding out now. All right? So it is not about the minister. He's broken more than 10 laws. Many of them are criminal. This is the problem we have had in this republic, for which reason the Special Prosecutor's Office was set up, where a person clearly has engaged in criminal conduct, but it's a sitting minister, and it seems that that person has the cover of his government, and for which reason it is not what will happen to him. This is $2 million and a slew of criminal activity. If any ordinary person has done a tenth of this, that person will be in serious trouble. Now, it's a test for the Special Prosecutor. There will be no excuse for him not to take up this matter and deal with it properly. And if he does not, it will go down in history as well. There is no way anybody who does not have political power or cover will be able to one do this and to get away with it. And like the parliament, the man basically never tried to even do the government to government. That vaccine was not even approved. That middle person, middle man, was not known as a vaccine trader. And that person has a history. Okay, the Ameri deal came through the same people, and there was a lot of issue with it. I mean, with all that, how do you end up in that same situation with a person? And then you go to Parliament and clearly tell untruth about it, pretend you don't know things that you know, you sign papers, and then you go and say, no, it is not so. And you know, look, it's terrible. I don't know anything that has not been breached in this process. So for me, the Attorney General can take up some of the issues. Parliament itself has been breached, and they can take up some of the issues there. The Special Prosecutor can take up some of the issues. This is about cleansing the state. It's about making sure that we have a system that we can all respect, so that people who act in such a brazen way, okay, will at least know that there is a certain price to pay. And it is all politics. Otherwise, we will not be where we are right now. So we are all watching to see what will happen.
We're all watching to see what will happen. When I return from this break, and I must make the point that all attempts to get the chairman of the health committee, Efrieh Ayu, to be part of this conversation, and his the deputy majority leader, Afenyomo Akins, to be part of this conversation, proved futile. But when I return from this break, we'll be talking about what precedents we should set to ensure that this does not recur. And I'll put the direct question, health minister, to resign or not to resign. Stay with me. Welcome back to PM Express. We're discussing the report that was submitted by the Sputnik V committee in Parliament that probed that procurement made by the health minister. And we're talking about the fact that the minister has breached a lot of constitutional procedures and what should happen to him. Should he resign or should he be relieved of his post? Mr. Ahiafo, your line dropped earlier. If you're back, you were explaining to me why you could not ask the minister where the those 20,000 vaccines procured are.
Yes, I indicated that because the committee was giving terms of reference, and we try as much as possible limiting ourselves to the terms of reference.
And the fact that you think members of the majority are trying to hide something?
Well, I do not see it that way, because the fact is very clear. It's unambiguous. It is absolute. So I do not see how the majority members in Parliament will try and then be doing a cover-up. No, the exposure has been made by the committee. Everything is out there. The committee was able to establish that, minister, you did it without even the advice coming from the Attorney General's department. He himself admitted he didn't have executive approval or cabinet approval. He himself admitted, I did not come to parliament to seek approval. He himself admitted that, look, I did this without involving the procurement authority. But he only wrote a letter to the procurement authority seeking for ratification under Section 93C of the Public Procurement Act. For us, where you don't have a breach, why are you seeking for ratification? What do you want them to ratify? Now, if you look at the law, the procurement authority is not under obligation so to do. They can even call for the entire contract to be cancelled. They can call for an amendment. Or where the breach is not serious, they may ask that the breach be rectified. So we even went ahead to question the whole transaction. Food and Drugs Authority was not basically even involved. So at the end of the day, it is established that the minister erred. No amount of exigency will be able to exonerate the minister. We made the minister aware that as parliament, we even do things under a certificate of urgency. So no matter the urgency involved, we have even been passing bills through certificate of urgency, where the bill will be taken through all the stages in one day. So if you are going to procure a Sputnik V vaccine for Ghanaian, and there is urgency involved, between the period of taking the decision to procure, a period of negotiation, and before entering the contract, you could have come to Parliament to seek prior approval. Parliament will be glad to consider it under certificate of emergency and then give you the approval. Mm. You could write to the Public Procurement Authority because the law is clear in Section 40, setting out the circumstances where a single source procurement will be engaged in under Section 41. Mm. But what you need to be able to do that is you must write to the Board of Public Procurement Authority for approval.
Certainly, but that did not happen.
Yes.
In this circumstance, that did not happen. Let me bring in Adam Senano. Mr. Senano, we've seen a letter that has been written to Sheikh Al Maktoum to refund the monies given to him. But beyond this, as we wait to see whether those monies will be refunded or not, what do you want to see as immediate steps taken by government?
Well, clearly we need to do a lot more investigation as to the processes that were followed and who was involved. Kofi has pointed out, this is such a monumental failure that you want to be sure that anybody on the chain who knew better and ought to have stopped this process and did not do so is held accountable. And I am of particular concern about the Ministry of Finance processes that led to the payment. How on earth did this money to get through that whole process without the PPA approval, without the parliamentary approval, and what have you, and yet was paid? Because you see, if we don't deal with those systems, the likelihood that this could happen easily again is very high. So we need to get to the bottom of what is the paper trail, on whose desk did it fall? Who minuted, what approvals, what did they say? Because you are not supposed to be able to move the documentation forward without certain supporting information. How was that able to happen in this situation? And having said that, I just want to point out to my brother, Mr. Hereford, that look, we are not satisfied with the parliamentary recommendations. It doesn't matter what he says about the terms of reference. Because you see, in 11.1.2 of their own report, they say that the minister breached Article 1815. And then they go into 11.1.3 to say, we recommend that in future. When I read that part of the of their report, it tells me that if you could go ahead to make recommendations for the future and say they should consult stakeholders, they should make sure parliamentary approval, what about now? How come that part where you're able to establish that there was a breach and going to recommend that in future? Once you're able to put that in your report, you should have been able to say that now he should be held accountable to Standing Order 2015. 28, something or that, 29, etc. And Parliament and the committee should not think that we have not observed or identified that this report was silent on their colleague. And I'm saying that because, you see, Ghanaians are getting very tired of being betrayed by the political elite, by Parliament and what have you. So for them to think they've gotten away with this and just say, oh, our terms of reference, please, we are not convinced. I am not convinced, and I'm sure many other people observing are not convinced. So you need to be very careful. Let's make sure you've done a good job in highlighting the facts, but the recommendation section, even by the extent of what you've already put there, would have gone further to highlight the standing orders that have been breached, including other things and the actions potentially that Parliament should consider, not so much making, say, this should be a sanction or not. So just to put that on the table as well.
Okay. Mr. Kofi Bento, what should be the precedent that should be established on this issue so that in future we don't see this?
I have to agree entirely with Adam on this one. I earlier said that the committee's work looked incomplete, but we will take the excuse that they were going to report to a bigger group, and the group should complete the work. We do these things for posterity. We do these things to set down a rule. As we go on, we try to build a more perfect union. And in trying to build a more perfect union, these examples or these experiences help us, you know, to do things right for other people, posterity to look up to. So I hope they will do a more thorough job. And when it comes to precedent, like I said at first, this thing gives the special prosecutor a perfect platform to take off on. This is exactly why that office was set up. If they do not do anything about this, it will become ammunition against them and the occupants of that office. It also constitutes extremely bad record for this government, and that will not be forgotten. How it will be narrated in future, however, depends on how it is handled from here on. In terms of even record keeping and making sure that we do the necessary thing, by now, all the paperwork involved in this transaction should have been taken over by the Attorney General for criminal investigation. You know, there is criminal negligence and there is benign negligence. Benign negligence is omission, where you are not aware of something and therefore you omitted to do something, or you did not know what you were doing and something honestly went wrong. But there is criminal negligence, which requires you to know what you are doing and to actually commit certain things. You have a situation here where somebody signed documents, somebody entered agreements, somebody did things, and then proceeded to tell a different story. All that paperwork should by now be part of an investigation. I'm not saying this necessarily against the minister alone. I'm saying it for the fact that this is how we build a nation. This is how we make corruption expensive. This is how we give a signal to everybody that when you are dealing with public funds and public office, you must appreciate that you are working on behalf of other people who would ask questions, okay? If this is not done, I guarantee you, this will be a ringing bell in the ears of this government come the next election. Because even right now, the issue of resignation or sack, I don't think we should have been talking about this by now. Resignation is a personal matter. If the man decides not to resign, I don't know what else is being considered before he is removed from his office, okay? And the person who is having that, you know, consideration or thinking about what to do will be questioned over time, okay, and asked what was taking so long before he made a decision to remove somebody who had signed papers illegally, not taken authorization, used government money. And by the way, nothing stops Mr. Maktoum or His Highness Maktoum from ignoring our letter. And if they do, what are we going to do about it? Okay, so whoever is thinking or considering what to do, the question is, what are you waiting for? For me, how we handle this is going to signal to us whether we are serious about fighting corruption and malfeasance of public officials or not. And we have instituted several, you know, bodies to deal with this. Attorney General's Department can deal with it. Parliament can deal with it. Shraj can deal with it. Special Prosecutor can deal with it. The Chief of Staff can deal with it. The President can deal with it. Look, even Council of State can call. Definitely. I don't know what else we need to see for public officials to book.
Let me put the direct question now. Should the minister resign or not to resign?
I said resignation is a personal matter. It has gone beyond resignation. The minister should not be in office right now. Because every day he spends in office, he will not be working for us. He will be working to cover up what he has done, and he will be working to make sure he can use his office to defend himself. So for me, it's not about resignation anymore.
It should be sacked.
All the documents should be in the hands of an investigative organ.
I'm grateful for your time. Kofi Bentele is a lawyer and vice president of Imani Africa. And Adam Senanu, who also joined his anti-corruption crusader. We're also joined by Bernard Ahia for his MP for Akachi South, a member of the Sputnik V committee that probed the matter. My name is Aisha Ibrahim. Many thanks for watching. Enjoy the rest of our programs.